Coming up next, Tom Brokaw takes a special look back at the Battle of Pearl Harbor, rare footage and new stories from survivors on the battle that changed their lives and American history. Pearl Harbor, Legacy of Attack, next here on NBC. And that's all for this edition of Dateline Sunday. We'll see you again for Dateline Monday at 8, 7 Central. I'm Stone Phillips, and for all of us at NBC News, good night.
For a transcript of tonight's broadcast or to purchase a video segment, call 1-800-420-2626.
Very nice work, everybody. See you back here tomorrow night.
Dateline is a presentation of NBC News. More Americans watch NBC News than any other news organization in the world.
Why your allergy drug may not work. NBC Nightly News this week.
I'm Tom Brokaw. Join me for a special edition of National Geographic Channel presents Pearl Harbor, Legacy of Attack.
Pearl Harbor, one morning that changed the world.
Place is breaking loose. Bombs dropping, machine gun fire.
Claiming thousands of lives from a sleeping nation.
He's coming in low enough, I can see the man's face.
And changing history forever. But today, questions still remain.
The first shot was fired out here, and it was fired by a U.S. destroyer.
What really happened that day? Now, journey back in time as National Geographic relives the stories of warriors and heroes and ventures inside the USS Arizona, unseen for nearly 60 years.
God help our country if it's ever forgotten.
Tom Brokaw hosts as the National Geographic Channel presents Pearl Harbor, Legacy of Attack.
December 6, 1941. Darkness has settled over the U.S. Navy base at Pearl Harbor. Thousands of sailors and soldiers are returning from shore leave, unaware of the attack that is about to be launched against them. Welcome to a special edition of National Geographic Channel Presents. I'm Tom Brokaw. That terrible day that we call Pearl Harbor happened 60 years ago. You might think that time has healed all the wounds, that the shock has worn off, that historians have told us all the stories there are to tell. That's not true. Pearl Harbor was so unexpected, so brutal, so chaotic, that we're still struggling to understand all that happened that day. Undersea explorer Robert Ballard wants to fill in some of the gaps. He's on the trail of a secret Japanese weapon, a flotilla of midget submarines that were trying to penetrate Pearl Harbor before the attack. This, then, is a story of secrecy and treachery, of Japanese warriors preparing to die for their country, of Americans completely unprepared for a day that would change their lives forever. They were 18, or 19, or 20 years old, sailors in a tropical paradise. They didn't know that on the other side of the ocean, another group of young men was preparing to strike them while they slept. Their paths would cross for a few short hours on a Sunday morning in December. And in one terrifying instant, more than 1,000 of them would die. The legacy of what happened on December 7th still haunts us today. In the first images from inside the USS Arizona, an underwater cemetery that's also an ecological time bomb. In the search for a top secret Japanese submarine that was sunk about an hour before the attack began.
The submarine's heading north, starting to dive.
And in the quest to learn what really happened that day. And most of all, It still lives on in the memories of the men who were there when everything changed.
Just a young kid when this happened. And I've lived through it. I lost a lot of my friends.
I reached down to try to help him. I scared me.
All came off.
But I hope it never happens again. Nobody will ever know what it was like, except somebody that was actually there.
They never had a chance. They didn't know what was coming. Nobody knew about it. They never woke up.
This is the story of a day when the history of the world took an unexpected turn at a sleepy little port in Hawaii called Pearl Harbor. Hawaii in the first summer of the new millennium. 60 years ago, on this island, a battle was fought, perhaps the most one-sided battle in American history. It plunged the United States into war, and in the space of a little more than 2 hours, took the lives of 2,400 Americans. Ever since that day, Pearl Harbor has been a place of pilgrimage. Many of the men who lived through the attack have returned at least once to remember what happened and to pay their respects to friends who didn't make it.
We remember December 7, 1941, when so many gave the last devotion of their
Well, it was kind of hard, yes, I'll admit it, because I couldn't do anything that the other guys could. I was only 5'3" and weighed 125 pounds. My battle station was a number two loader on a 5-inch gun, and I couldn't even pick up the shells that had to be put in the gun.
How can this ever happen? One of the strongest navies in the world, and we're sitting here with our pants down. We got caught, period.
It was one of the best assignments in the Navy. A sailor joining the Pacific Fleet in Hawaii could expect warm air, lots of sunshine, and plenty of things to do on shore leave. In the Atlantic Theater, things were different. Europe had been at war for more than 2 years. Hitler's soldiers occupied Paris. London was being blitzed by Nazi bombs. For sailors stationed in the Pacific, there was only one threat on the horizon. Yet most Americans knew next to nothing about the country or its people, who were thought to be short and nearsighted. Quaint little people, ruled by an old-fashioned emperor. In reality, Japan was a modern military power that had signed a pact with Nazi Germany. Japanese troops brutally occupied parts of China and were poised to move against other neighbors. But the United States Pacific Fleet stood in the way. And early in 1941, the Japanese military decided to do something about that.
Why would Japan want to go to war with the United States? What Japan wanted was the oil fields in the Dutch East Indies. What they wanted was the tin and the rubber out of Malaya. They wanted the Philippines because of its strategic location. Nobody thought that they would ever come out to Pearl Harbor. That's how you achieve surprise in war. You attack where nobody expects it.
It was the brainchild of a 57-year-old Japanese admiral named Isoroku Yamamoto. Yamamoto decided to strike the U.S. fleet at its home base, at anchor in the cramped, shallow harbor near Honolulu.
For Yamamoto, he had studied in the United States. He had gone to Harvard. He knew what the Americans were like. And he said at one point, I don't care if we march troops down Pennsylvania Avenue, we're not going to conquer the United States. He planned the attack with the idea that if we're going to have any chance of winning this war, we've got to destroy the American fleet. And that'll give us 6 months to run wild in the Southwest Pacific. And we can build up a defensive barrier that will be very difficult for the Americans to crack. And at some point, they're going to say, we quit. You keep your gains.
In the spring of 1941, planning for the attack began in earnest, although only a handful of Japanese officers knew about it. A talented pilot named Minoru Genda was given the task of figuring out how to inflict maximum damage on the American fleet, especially its battleships and carriers, in a surprise attack from the air. Genda decided that a combination of bombs and torpedoes modified to operate in shallow waters would have the best chance of success. Late that summer and into the fall, Japanese pilots trained for their top secret mission. They rehearsed the low altitude attack angles they would need over the harbor. They practiced strafing runs over and over. By fall, Yamamoto's plan had evolved into a mammoth undertaking that would require 6 carriers, more than 350 airplanes, and almost as an afterthought, 5 midget submarines. Those 5 midget submarines played a curious and little-known part in the attack, and an expedition is getting underway in Honolulu to learn more. One of the tiny subs almost cost Japan the critical element of surprise.
And there's only 2 outliers.
And that's
Target
the one undersea explorer Robert Ballard is hoping to find.
To the east.
For the man who found the Titanic and the Bismarck, this search represents a unique challenge. It's one of the smallest ships Ballard's ever looked for, and no one really knows where it sank.
Nice to meet you.
Joining him will be a man who was part of the submarine task force 6 decades ago, Kichiji Dewa. The midget sub they'll be looking for was sunk by an American destroyer well before the attack began and could have alerted American forces, but did not.
So, gentlemen, I'd like to introduce some colleagues here.
Good morning, sir.
Will Lehner and Russ Reitz were there when it happened.
This is Dewa.
Glad that we can be friends.
For Ballard, the expedition offers an opportunity to clear up a common misconception.
I think most people think that the first shot was fired with the Japanese as they swooped over the Polly and descended on our sleeping fleet that Sunday morning. But in fact, the first shot was fired out here, and it was fired by a U.S. destroyer.
Not only was it the first shots fired by America in the war, it should have alerted us to that something was going on. I find it incredibly ironic that the attack and sinking of this Japanese submarine an hour before the planes arrived did not alert us. And I just find that to be amazing.
Ballard's tight schedule only allows him 2 weeks for the mission, sponsored by National Geographic. But the search area isn't too large, and he does have the right equipment. Now, all he needs is a little luck.
We gotta get it out.
From the Titanic to Roman wrecks, Ballard has relied as much on instinct as science to find lost ships. But now, that rare combination of luck and skill may not be enough. We'll be back with more in a moment.
Tomorrow, the sun will rise, and the stars will fade. Routines will begin, and routines will end. And predators will hunt their prey, and prey will outrun their predators. A new language will be learned. An old language will be forgotten. There will be breakthroughs, and there will be blunders. And there will be more of everything, and there will be less. The sun will rise tomorrow on a place far different than the world today. Every day on the new National Geographic Channel.
NBC's presentation of Pearl Harbor, Legacy of Attack, is being sponsored in part by Best Western, the world's largest hotel chain.
Just about anywhere on Earth you want to go, you'll find a Best Western. After all, we're the largest hotel chain in the world. Over 4,000 hotels in over 80 countries, all inviting you to get a good night's sleep. Best Western, the world's largest hotel chain. Call 1-800-WESTERN or visit bestwestern.com.
Summer must be here. Time for the JCPenney Memorial Day Sale with 20 to 50% savings on everything for summer. Plus, take an extra 10% off with your Penny's card. It's all inside. Summer's on. JCPenney.
Here's something new from Pledge.
Pledge Grab It, a dry dusting mitt.
Dusting gloves. Oh, I can't wait to try this.
This is a good invention.
See, there's little areas here that haven't been done in a while.
Go in every little tiny groove.
Okay, that's a lot easier.
Wonderful. The glove gets into every little ridge.
This is very easy to get to the crevices.
This grabs it, holds it there.
Works like a magnet. It's a thumbs up, definitely.
Grab it!
New Pledge Grab It Dry Dusting Mitts. S.E. Johnson, a family company.
Own the original Pearl Harbor Epic. Tora, Tora, Tora. Now available on video and DVD.
This man got his auto insurance over the web and his homeowner's insurance through an 800 number. Now what? Introducing the Good Hands Network, only from Allstate, where you always get an agent, no matter how you come to us, through allstate.com, 1-800-ALLSTATE, or your local agent. It's the best way yet to put you in good hands.
Crazy about seafood? Try one of our favorite creations, lobster scallops and shrimp. Now with a complimentary shrimp cocktail. Red Lobster. Go overboard.
Oh, yes! Yes! She's got
beer. I wish I could have an organic experience.
You've never had one?
I love herbal essences, but I need intense conditioning.
Honey, meet your new best friend.
New Herbal Essences Intensive Blends. Creamier, vitamin enriched. Improves hair's condition up to 85%.
It's her first time.
Herbal Essences Intensive Blends.
Guys, the bottle says repeat.
Thousands of people will win. Great prizes, new cars, and millions of advantage miles. Playing NBC's trivia game, NBC IQ. All you need to play is a free QTV kit from Radio Shack. Then watch NBC and play NBC IQ. Find out how at any Radio Shack or NBCI.com.
The Bucks won a hard-nosed battle to grab the upper hand. Now, can Allen Iverson recover from injury and help the Sixers tie the series? Monday, 5 Eastern, NBC.
Introducing the all-new AutoVision Entertainment System. Now playing in a WinStar near you.
Now at your Metro Detroit Ford dealers, get $2,000 cash back on all 2001 WinStars.
Pearl Harbor, Legacy of Attack, continues now on NBC.
November 26th, 1941. The Japanese armada slipped out of port and headed east through wintry seas. Six carriers were grouped at the center of the formation, surrounded by a protective ring of cruisers, battleships, and destroyers. Some 30 ships in all. Because the success of the mission rested on taking the Americans totally by surprise, their route would take them well north of commercial shipping lanes. If another ship spotted them, the mission would be in jeopardy and possibly called off. Strict radio silence was maintained at all times as the attack force moved into position, while far to the south, five Japanese submarines were already closing in on the island of Oahu. Each mother sub, as it was called, carried one midget submarine lashed to its afterdeck. Together, they made up the most controversial element of the strike force.
The Japanese wanted to put everything that they had into this attack, and they had midget submarines. And so let's use them was Yamamoto's decision. Now, there were people in the Japanese high command that objected strongly to that. Don't bring submarines into Pearl Harbor. In the first place, they're not going to get in. In the second place, they're not going to do much damage if they do. And in the third place, and by far more important, that's going to tip off the Americans that an attack is coming. It's going to put the Americans up in general quarters all across Pearl Harbor and all across Hawaii. So don't use them.
But they did use them. Each midget sub would carry a two-man crew into battle, 10 hand-picked, highly trained young men who were prepared to die for their country. On the night before the attack, they would penetrate Pearl Harbor, wait on the bottom for the planes to strike, then fire their two torpedoes at any large ship in their range. If circumstances permitted, they would try to leave the harbor and rendezvous with the mother subs. But no one really expected the submariners to return.
They were young, they were enthusiastic, they were courageous, they were ready to go out and die for the emperor, and it was a suicide mission. Nobody said that quite that way, but that's what it was, a suicide mission. And these guys were eager for it.
There was no sense of impending tragedy. Everyone felt that we were simply carrying out our duty by taking part in military action, though I felt that they might never make it back.
Day one of the search. About 2 miles outside the narrow channel that leads into Pearl Harbor. It was here, somewhere, that a destroyer called the USS Ward was patrolling in the early hours of December 7th.
I was thinking that we were a little more that way, but
My breath says no, we were more of this.
Yeah.
But we were.
Well, then you average those two, right?
It's the history that tells you what you need to know. And so you have to steep yourself in the history, and you have to read all sorts of sources because a lot of history is conflicting. One book will say one thing, one book will say another thing. And so you have to find out, well, what do we all agree upon, and where is the uncertainty? Here the uncertainty was, where were they exactly when the attack took place?
Coming in from another direction. And all of the historical databases.
Well, you know, after the war, and in fact during the war, this became a dumping site. And our biggest fear is that they dump something right on top of what we're looking for. So basically what you have down here is a museum of World War II. We don't know what the currents are going to be like. We don't know what the visibility is going to be like. We don't know how the ship's going to perform. So today is a big learning curve. Day one of our expedition.
Enough.
Ballard decides the work will go faster if he adds another machine to the mix, a remotely operated vehicle called Little Herc.
Well, it's
imaging ROV. It moves very rapidly. We can cover a lot of ground quick and see a lot of targets quick. So it's just a good way to go.
Little Herc is tethered behind a bulkier imaging system called Argus, and the two vehicles descend to 600 feet. In the control room, the team gets its first glimpse of the sea floor.
Here's a, what's this coming up? The cylinder. Is that a torpedo? No, piece of pipe.
This is really exciting. Every little thing looks like part of it.
Well, it looks like it. These are depth charges. There's a whole bunch of them. There's another one.
As the first few days of the search come to an end, they've seen a lot of debris and not much else. Saturday night, December 6th, 1941. Sailors on shore leave filled the bars on Hotel Street in Honolulu. The usual Saturday night crowd gathered for dinner and dancing. At Hickam Field, the airplanes were parked wingtip to wingtip. And in the harbor, the warships of the Pacific Fleet prepared for the night. California, Oklahoma, Maryland, Tennessee, West Virginia, Arizona, Nevada. The last day of peace in the United States was coming to an end.
Pearl Harbor, Legacy of Attack will continue on NBC.
Okay, so you're set up with Total Choice programming, and sir, I also hooked up the NFL Sunday Ticket subscription you signed up for.
That's for her.
Oh, so you've also got Fox Sports Net. You get your regional sports.
College basketball.
ESPN Full Court.
What about racing?
Horses.
Stock cars.
All right.
Yeah.
Okay.
Now get free professional installation when you buy a DirecTV system and sign up for any DirecTV programming package.
It was over in 2 hours. And yet, in a brief moment, a nation lost its innocence. We had no choice but to walk forward. For from the ashes of Pearl Harbor rose a spirit so strong that defeat was no longer an option. It is to those who carried this spirit we dedicate the G.I. Joe Pearl Harbor Collection. Authentically recreated, it will stand as a proud reminder of a day that changed the world forever.
Get a jump on the big Memorial Day weekend sale at Sears for big savings on big brands. Plus, get 0% till January 2002 on all home appliances, TVs, and camcorders when you use your Sears card. It doesn't get any bigger than this, only through Monday at Sears.
Come on, let's go.
Sweetie, I'm sorry. I can't stand the line. We're going to miss our flight. Well, I wish you could go, too.
Yes, I know how much you love Walt Disney World, but we can't take you with us this time.
Well, for one thing, I don't think your wife and children would appreciate it.
Okay.
If you think a Walt Disney World vacation isn't the same without the kids, you're absolutely right. Call 1-407-W-DISNEY and make the dream come true.
We're here at the courthouse where a protest rally is being held to free the Presbyopic Six, who were arrested for an incident at a local bookstore where they were protesting their right to see better.
Thoughtless people call it middle-aged sight. The medical term is presbyopia.
Free the Presbyopic Six!
Non-dairy, right?
With
yes,
the new eyeglass thanks. Lenses from Verilux, you see near, far, and everything in between. Technologically, nothing else comes close.
We want
they want to see the way they were meant to see. Is that too much to ask?
Near, far, and in between, we want freedom.
This is a first, the best deal ever. Gardner White's Memorial Weekend Sale. You pay no interest till May 2003. No interest this year or next year. Not one cent of interest till May 2003. That's two full years, and Gardner White pays your sales tax. The furniture savings are massive. 40, 60, up to 70% off. Guaranteed lowest prices. You cannot find a better deal, period. 0% interest for two full years, and we pay your sales tax. Don't miss the final hours, Monday, Memorial Day, 10 to 6. Be there.
You've probably seen great shows. You've probably been entertained in fine style. But now, it's time you experienced something more. More entertainment. More great shows. Casino Windsor. Absolutely more of what you're looking for.
Zach, the lip ring is caught on my braces.
Don't move.
Call someone?
I'm not using my minutes.
Just use them.
I'll call after 8 when my rates go down.
That's 4 hours away.
3.5. Don't be so dramatic.
Hey, she's young. Maybe her next boyfriend will have voice dreams whenever minutes.
The most whenever minutes, only from voice dream.
This happens to me all the time.
Looking for an extended cab pickup with the most standard horsepower and unbeatable fuel economy? Get a GMC Sierra. Looking for a compact pickup engineered with room for 5? Get the all-new GMC Sonoma Crew Cab. Looking for up to $2,500 cash back on a pickup? Get to your GMC dealer by May 31st. Get $1,000 back on Sierra Extended Cabs. $2,500 back on Sonoma. See the pros at your GMC dealer before these Memorial Day deals are history.
Get in the locker room.
Tonight, get it.
Pearl Harbor, the secret Japanese submarines are poised, ready for action. If they fail, they could inadvertently alert the American forces that an attack is coming. The stakes could not be higher as the battle draws near.
December 7th, 1941, a few minutes after midnight. 10 miles away from the mouth of Pearl Harbor, the 5 mother submarines prepared to launch the Midgets. The Japanese crews could see the lights on Waikiki and make out strains of jazz when the wind shifted. Each of the submariners wrote a letter to his parents. Sadamu Kamita was a quiet mountain boy who loved baseball.
Forgive this negligent son for not writing these long months. We are soon to be dispatched to regions unknown. Should anything happen to me, do not grieve or mourn. Should I fail to write, do not be alarmed. For it means I am well and discharging my duties faithfully. Goodbye. The night before they left, Commander Yokoyama, his crewman Kamita, and I went to the officer's mess that normally enlisted men couldn't enter. We ate a farewell dinner. Later, there was a small party in the officer's wardroom.
Dewa watched his friends enter the Midget sub and spoke to Yokoyama one last time over a phone link.
I said something like, take care to them. I didn't say anything special, just words of parting said on the phone, very normal. Even though the fact that they wouldn't return was a foregone conclusion, we didn't talk about it.
The Midget carried by Dewa submarine was the first to leave, released into the water around 1 a.m. By 3 a.m., all the midgets were making their way toward the harbor, except the one skippered by Ensign Sakamaki. He was having trouble with his gyroscope. Without it, he'd have to take his bearings on the surface and risk being spotted by an American ship.
You're sneaking into a harbor, and you don't want to trip the alarm and let the Americans know that the war has begun. And so you must be extremely nervous. You've got to be just on pins and needles.
And then, the first missed opportunity for the Americans. At 3:42 a.m., an officer on board the minesweeper Condor spotted a periscope in the water 50 yards off the port bow. Condor alerted the ward patrolling the approaches to Pearl Harbor.
Remember about 3:30 or so, the skipper called general quarters about 3:20, 3:30. I don't remember the exact time, but remember that?
I remember that.
And we thought, what kind of a skipper is this? He just came aboard, and now we got general quarters, and he's going to start drilling us. And
it was just a drill.
That skipper is going to be a tough one to live with. But he was one of the best skippers we ever had, remember?
But the ward's new skipper misunderstood the message and went to look in the wrong place. The one thing Japanese planners feared most had occurred. 4 hours before the attack, one of their ships had been spotted, and nothing happened. Sunday, December 7th, around dawn. Aboard the six aircraft carriers, the pilots and planes of the first wave began to assemble. Yamamoto's plan called for two distinct waves of attack, the first to reach Honolulu at about 8 a.m., the second to follow within the hour. It meant getting the right aircraft into the air at the right time. Each wave would take about 15 minutes to launch. The first to go were 43 Mitsubishi fighters armed with machine guns and cannon, the dreaded Zeros. Then, 49 Nakajima bombers, Kates, each carrying a single 1,760-pound armor-piercing bomb. 51 Aichi dive bombers were next to leave, the Vals. And finally, another 40 Kates carrying specially modified torpedoes. At about 6:20 a.m., the planes formed up and headed south. At almost the same time the first wave turned toward Oahu, the U.S. Navy got its second report of intruders near the harbor. At 6:30 a.m., a lookout on the freighter Antares spotted another submarine periscope, then a conning tower. Once again, the ward raced to investigate, and this time, the destroyer found what she was looking for.
This submarine started to surface, and I'm midships right at the rail. And see, when I see this thing start to surface, I thought, wow, what's this?
Then the skipper took after this submarine. And of course, we didn't know it at the time, but later on, he told us that his first thought was ramming it. But he said, this is my first ship, and I don't want to ruin it.
all of a sudden, number one gun fired, and they missed because their elevation wasn't great enough. We were that close. And then number three gun fired, and I saw the splash, the water line of the conning tower as the shell hit the conning tower.
It must have rang like a bell. I mean, just must have been an incredible explosion that went off right next to their head. I mean, remember, the skipper is standing in the conning tower and the shell hit the conning tower. You would think he must have died instantly. Or did he? Because they then began to dive, so clearly they weren't dead. And they then began to dive, and no sooner did they dive than the depth charge was going off.
And then they exploded. And I didn't see the submarine as it came up, but I'm told that it came up, rolled over, and then went back down again.
After the depth charges that we dropped, I can't see any way it could have gotten away from us.
At 6:51 a.m., Skipper William Outerbridge of the Ward radioed headquarters that he had seen and fired upon an unidentified submarine. He repeated the message 2 minutes later. At headquarters, the Ward's terse report slowly worked its way up the chain of command. For the second time that morning, the Japanese had tripped the alarm. And for the second time that morning, nothing happened. Day 10 of Ballard's search, and still no sign of what they're looking for.
And that was in here.
The submarine was coming this way, and we were coming this way.
Why was this one on the surface?
Maybe he's not sure, but the passenger in the small submarine, they are looking, and then they make sure the position.
So far, Ballard has covered about 2 square miles of seabed in an area called the Flats, where the Ward was patrolling. So far, they've seen a lot of debris, but the missing sub has eluded them. Each time they pick up a promising target on sonar, it turns out to be something else. A crumpled seaplane used by the Navy in the late 20s and 30s. A Grumman Hellcat fighter. Then, part of a similar type of midget sub captured later in the war and then dumped. And finally, something that seems to have treads.
You think so? It's a tank. A tracked vehicle. Well, let's work it over.
So they don't want one thing.
Yeah, look.
Another day's search is coming to an end without results.
Hello, Robert. Yeah. Not out in the flats, so
very good.
The only place left is up against the wall.
Yeah.
Yep.
So tomorrow we'll come out with the two subs and take it right in next to the channel and look at the base of the wall, which we couldn't do with these vehicles.
Good.
They've used up most of their allotted 2 weeks with nothing to show for it. For Bob Ballard and his team, time is running out.
Pearl Harbor Legacy of Attack will continue on NBC.
Around here, it's not every day we all get together.
We're making them dinner.
Come on, you guys.
But when we do, it's great that the folks at Kraft make Italian.
I love this stuff.
Because it's the one thing we agree on. That way, we can talk about what's on our minds instead of what's on our plates.
Whose idea was it?
Mikhail has a boyfriend.
I guess they just know what we like.
A what?
He's a senior.
He's a senior?
Around here, the dressing is Kraft. Try new ranch and Caesar bacon dressings made with Oscar Mayer bacon.
I can take pain, but not sunscreen that runs into my eyes and stings.
Coppertone Sports Sunscreen, ultra sweatproof.
I can take any height, but not sunscreen that affects my grip.
Coppertone Sport, ultra dry. Coppertone Sport, the number one preferred sports sunscreen.
Best crackers in the world can do this in 60 minutes. I need someone who can do it in 60 seconds.
Go!
This summer, you can run. You can drive. You can fly.
This is now an aerial pursuit.
Because on June 8th, one word will get you where you need to go. From the producer of The Matrix.
Oh, yeah.
Swordfish, rated R, starts Friday, June 8th, in theater near you.
Feeling a little nervous about getting on the bus?
Yeah, I don't want to go.
You have to go to school.
I don't know if I want to go, though.
That'll be fun.
I want to hang out with you.
Girls' first day. Be nice. First days are always a little scary.
I'm gonna miss you.
It's gonna be a bright.
Chevy Malibu. It's dependable. Just like you. Sunshine. Chevy Malibu. We'll be there.
What will it take for you to talk to your doctor about Zocor? Zocor, be there.
Two Coors Lights?
Ah, football, sweet. This game's gonna be played in the air. Ah, Coors Light, I'm on for dude. Nah, wasn't ready for one. Look at that, Nickelback offense, right on. Calls for a little Rocky Mountain napkin. Ah, third and 11, let's get things downfield. What are they doing? Oh, we huddling up? Not the face, not the hair.
Mondays at 9, 8 Central, it's Weakest Link.
You got another question, Rob.
Is there any beginning to your knowledge?
You really don't know what you're doing.
Who left their brains at home?
And all the other players hate you.
Kim. Pathetic.
You're the weakest link, weakest link. You're super weak.
Weakest Link, NBC Mondays at 9, 8 Central.
Is there a village that needs its idiot back?
You're the weakest link, weakest link. Your link is weak.
You are the weakest link.
Every NBC Monday, six real people will face three terrifying challenges in a battle of sheer nerve.
These are not your friends. These are your opponents.
They play against their worst fears and against each other.
Whoa, look at this.
How many of you want to see Jeanette eat it bad?
You think anybody's going to quit?
I'm going to try to make them.
This is not the Boy Scouts.
Oh, my God!
Fear Factor, NBC Mondays in 3 weeks.
On airfields such as this one, American warplanes are parked in neat rows as if for the convenience of the Japanese attackers. The U.S. early warning system is about to detect something ominous, but it's Sunday morning, and no one is paying much attention.
December 7th, 1941, 7 a.m. A mobile radar station on the northwest coast of Oahu picked up the signal of a massive number of aircraft approaching the island from the north. They were less than 140 miles away, moving at 180 miles an hour. A telephone call went immediately to the information center in Honolulu, 40 miles to the southeast. The call was routed to a private named McDonald, who passed it on to a Lieutenant Tyler, who had just been assigned to the job. Tyler told the radar operators not to worry about it. In his mind, it was just a squadron of American B-17s due in from the mainland. For the third time that day, the Japanese had tripped the alarm. And for the third time, no one seemed to notice. It was 7:15 a.m. At 7:40 a.m., the first wave of airplanes reached the coast of Oahu, guided by the signal from a Honolulu radio station. The bombers and torpedo planes were at 9,000 feet. 5,000 feet above them, the Zeros flew cover. The first wave began to break up into their attack formations. One to fly inland toward Wheeler Airfield. The other to move down the western coast to Pearl Harbor. They were the only planes in the sky. There was no sign whatsoever that the Americans knew they were about to be attacked. At 7:50 a.m., the first wave reached Pearl Harbor. Among their first targets, Hickam Airfield and the Naval Air Base on Ford Island. Clarence Miner was an airman stationed on Ford Island.
After all that noise in the tin roof up there and stuff were popping around, I looked up and I saw this airplane come diving down in that big meatball, and I said, oh. And then all hell all over the place was breaking loose. Bombs dropping, machine gun fire. And like I said, the things were so darn low you could throw rocks at them.
Ralph Lindenmeyer was also on Ford Island.
7:55 in the morning, an explosion woke us up. I looked up at the clock when I first heard the explosion and felt it, and I said, the Japs are here. And when I looked out the window, the plane came over, and it had saw the meatball on the fuselage and the wings, and I could look into the pilot's face, and I could almost see him grinning.
Anchored on Pier 1010 was the utility vessel Argonne, where 19-year-old Charles Christensen worked in the machine shop.
That was a bad explosion. I wonder what happened. And I opened the porthole up, and I stuck my head right on out there, you know, and oh, boy, was there ever a fire on Ford Island. I thought, oh, my goodness, something is really bad blowing up over there.
It took a while for sailors in the ships at anchor to comprehend what was happening. Bert Davis, a machinist mate on the USS Selfridge, thought it was some kind of readiness drill.
That's where I was standing when the plane came in. I was standing there shining my shoes. And I saw these planes coming in. Came in. Came right straight across where the Raleigh was. And I thought to myself, what in the hell is the Army doing holding maneuvers on a day like this?
While the dive bombers hammered the airfields, the torpedo planes descended to an altitude of a few dozen feet and took dead aim at Battleship Row. Aboard the Argonne, Charles Christensen had a perfect view of the first torpedo runs.
He's coming in almost straight across me at a slight angle across, and he's low enough that he's maybe 30 feet off of the water, which puts him maybe eye level or a little more from me, and I can see the man's face. He's got his helmet on, he's got his goggles on, and he's looking over the side. And when he straightened that plane out, leveled it out, he dropped that torpedo, and I thought, oh my God, look at that. And that torpedo just went as straight for the Oklahoma as it could go.
This photo, taken from a Japanese plane, shows Battleship Row just after the attack began. The ripples emanating outward are the result of multiple torpedo strikes. George Smith was below deck on the Battleship Oklahoma when General Quarters sounded.
Then all of a sudden, the guy came over to the loudspeaker, this is no move it. And then we got a torpedo. I was really so scared, I didn't know what the hell was going on.
The Oklahoma, started to capsize almost immediately.
When they said abandoned ship, the only way we could get out was through the Kingsville window. We went out there, and the ship was rolling on top of us. Maybe we jumped about 5 feet into the water, which wasn't far. But when you turn around and see this thing coming on top of you, you swim for all you can swim and as fast as you can swim. Because we know we had to get around the big gun turrets. They were coming over next on us.
It went over so fast, I just was sure, I didn't know, but I was sure they were trapped inside of that because it just rolled right on over, and there it was, keel up.
George Smith had just been released from the Oklahoma's brig for going ashore without leave, and it saved his life.
And when the ship got the torpedo, the brig was in the carpenter shop on board ship. And when the torpedo hit, it broke the carpenter's workbench loose, pinned the guard against the wall, the bulkhead, and he couldn't release the other men that were in the brig, and they all drowned.
On the far side of Ford Island, the old battleship Utah also got hit a few minutes before 8. Clark Simmons worked on the Utah as a mess attendant.
And as I looked out the port, I saw a plane making a run on the Utah. And as she dropped her torpedo, the wing dipped, and then he straightened up, and the torpedo hit it, and another one right behind it did the same thing. And we knew that it was just a matter of time before the ship was going to sink. And actually, it took 8 minutes. In 8 minutes, the ship was history. She had turned turtle in 8 minutes.
As the lines would begin to part, came over the side and began to swim toward Ford Island. And as we were swimming, they were machine gunning us from both directions, from this direction, and when they came from Pearl City over here, from that direction. I saw fellas yelling and screaming. Some of the fellas in the water was asking for help. It was so chaotic. I really didn't know what was going on.
But the biggest blow was yet to come. Lying inboard of the repair ship Vestal was the battleship Arizona. High overhead, a Kate released an armor-piercing bomb that drifted down toward the Arizona's number 2 gun turret. It was about 10 minutes after 8. A motion picture camera captured the moment of impact. In that instant, more than 1,000 crewmen died. Stu Headley was on the West Virginia, a few hundred feet away.
One gigantic explosion. Now, when we fired the 16-inch, you're inside, it sounds like thunder up in the distance. But this didn't sound like no thunder. This was one gigantic explosion. The stern of our ship lifted out of the water, but at the same time we were getting hit with torpedoes, we were starting to list. But we saw about 32 men flying through the air from the Arizona.
Oil from the fully fueled Arizona began to spread and catch fire. The heat was so intense, even sailors on nearby ships were threatened.
So Crozen and I stripped right down to our undershorts and jumped in and swam underwater. Now, we're not underwater swimmers, but we swam underwater that day because that was the hottest breath of air we ever breathed. because that was the oil from the Arizona that was ablaze.
The bomb had penetrated Arizona's forward magazine and ignited more than 1 million pounds of gunpowder. Those who were still alive found themselves in an inferno.
They were in this oil that was on fire, and they were trying to swim out of it. They'd come up and trying to get their breath. Their eyes, the white of their eyes was just as red as they can be. I can just see it today. The skin on their face was just falling off. And on top of that, all of this oil, and they were just drenched in oil.
Bert Davis went out in a whaleboat to pick up survivors.
Oh God, it was horrible. Just one fella started to reach up to try to get a hold of the gunwale on the boat from the outside, and I reached down to try to help him, and I took him by the arm, and as I tried to lift like that, the skin all came off. He was dead by the time we got him in.
Thirty-five minutes after the attack began, the first wave flew away, leaving behind more than 1,000 dead American sailors, many of them teenagers, caught below deck when Arizona exploded and sank.
For the personal recollections of the Pearl Harbor survivors and an interactive map of the battle, log on to nationalgeographic.com.
Pearl Harbor, Legacy of Attack will return on NBC.
You try anything to get some relief from your nasal allergy symptoms. But before you change your life, make an easier change. Ask your doctor about Flonase. Multi-symptom Flonase relieves all these nasal allergy symptoms: sneezing, itchy, runny nose, and congestion. Multi-symptom Flonase once a day relieves them all day and night. For best results, use daily. Side effects are generally mild and may include headache, nosebleed, or sore throat. Call to learn more. So before you change your life, make an easier change. Ask your doctor about multi-symptom Flonase. When you get it all it takes is Flonase.
We quit using toothpaste.
Hey, your whole mouth needs protecting.
Not just your teeth.
Triple protection, Aquafresh does it all. It's three different toothpastes in one.
Aquafresh works as hard as we do.
It's the whole mouthpaste.
Right now, during Kia's Great May Sales event, you get more for less, like the Kia Optima. It comes with a 10-year, 100,000-mile warranty, and is available with more features: a V6 engine, dual front and seat-mounted side airbags, and leather interior. All this for a whole lot less. Because right now, we're offering 1.9% financing, which means the more you wait, the less chance you'll have of getting a great deal during Kia's Great May Sales event. Ends May 31st.
C-Dot. C-Dot, run. See where Dot gets all her energy.
I love this bed.
Sealy Posturepedic. We support you night and day.
Summer must be here. Time for the JCPenney Memorial Day Sale, with 20 to 50% savings on everything for summer. Plus, take an extra 10% off with your Penny's card. It's all inside. Summer's on. JCPenney.
Oh, a new patient.
I get a lot of new patients with fleas or ticks.
Oh, poor baby.
Even though their owners thought they protected them. Because only one product protects cats and dogs against fleas and ticks. New Frontline Plus. It's the best. Now it provides complete flea protection. And it's the only one that also kills ticks, including the ones that carry Lyme disease.
Oh, that's cute.
New Frontline Plus. For fleas and ticks, Frontline is the veterinarian's number one choice.
Tonight at 11, a joyride on Belle Isle ends with a deadly crash. The driver of the car isn't old enough to be behind the wheel. Good evening, I'm Michael Ann Wolf.
And I'm Art Edwards. New at 11 and only on 4.
A vicious dogfight out in the open. Police show up and everyone scatters. Local 4 cameras roll as the animals roam the streets.
New at 11, a 2-year-old is shocked by a down power line. Paramedics rush the child to the hospital to save his life.
And did Disney hype pay off, or did Pearl Harbor bomb at the box office?
Even though we just turned 60, we're still climbing mountains, trekking through forests, and playing in the mud. And now we're celebrating that heritage during the Jeep Anniversary Event. Get a $1,000 cash allowance and 0.9% APR financing when you buy a Grand Cherokee. Or returning Daimler Chrysler lessees with preferred credit can lease one for just $299 a month. So come celebrate our great past. It'll make for an exciting future. See your Chrysler and Jeep superstores.
Select and digitally record up to 35 hours of programming. No tapes. Ultimate TV. Watch what you can do.
Get in the locker room!
Tonight! Get it!
Less than 40 minutes into the attack on Pearl Harbor, America's ships and planes have been hit hard. The greatest single loss is the USS Arizona, which will become a symbol of the battle and the men who were lost.
6 decades after the attack on Pearl Harbor, the Arizona still lies where she sank with her cargo of sailors. Most of their bodies have never been recovered. Her superstructure was removed during the war. Only the mount of her number 3 turret remains above water. The Arizona was built nearly a century ago, and she spent more than half that time underwater. The National Park Service, which is responsible for maintaining the memorial, periodically checks on her condition. Her passageways and hatches, her 14-inch guns, the interior of the ship is too dangerous for divers, so it's never been investigated by the Park Service. Until now. With the help of a tiny ROV made available by National Geographic, workers will get their first glimpse of Arizona's condition deep inside the ship since about the time she went down. The initial survey reveals that the corrosion is worse than expected. And that may portend an ecological disaster because of something happening deep within the ship. The Arizona has been leaking an estimated quart of oil a day ever since she sank. But the Park Service is worried that the remaining bunkers could give way.
Current estimates are that there's approximately 500,000 gallons, possibly in the bunkers on the aft section of the ship. And so with current technology, can we get to those bunkers? And what's happening with the metal on the hull and the internal portions of the ship? And so that's what we're trying to do, is find out, is there a way that we can contain that oil?
The problem is complicated by the ship's designation as a grave site and by the oil's symbolic meaning.
Many visitors and survivors consider the oil to either be the tears of the ship or the ship is bleeding. We'll also be dealing with that emotional feelings that people have about the oil and the significance. It'll be a balance between what protecting the ecosystem is all about and protecting the tomb, the shrine that this place symbolizes.
Inside the memorial, a wall lists the 1,177 servicemen who died on the battleship. Every returning survivor knew someone who died on December 7th.
Oh, sweet up there. Smith, Randolph Smith, he got machine gun.
They never had a chance. They didn't know what was coming. Nobody knew about it. They never woke up.
Aloha. Aloha.
Oh, I was going to ask you for a big hug. I'm going to get one anyway.
Big hug.
I thought maybe...
Big hug. Let me give this lady a hug.
I thought maybe that you wouldn't want to hug an ugly old man.
Oh, I do. I do want it.
Carl Carson was a 20-year-old sailor on the Arizona the day she went down. He decided to come back to Pearl Harbor when doctors told him he didn't have much longer to live.
Well, I lost a lot of good, dear friends over there. It's just awful hard to even think about them. I almost lost my own life. I hope I can make it over there all right.
Carl has never talked very much about what happened to him that day. Now, at last, it's time.
This is where I came out of, turret three.
Here. Right.
Came back on this. There used to be ladders up and down the thing, and I came out the turret and went down. Well, I was out on deck doing the morning chores. All of a sudden, this plane come along and didn't pay much attention to it because planes were landing at Ford Island all the time. And all of a sudden, the chips started flying all around me, and there was a plane that was strafing me. And somebody hollered, "It's the damn Japs, get undercover." Bomb went off. I learned later it was back by turret number four, about where I'd been working about 10, 15 minutes before. And evidently, it knocked me out, ruptured both my lungs, and I got smoke inhalation, and all the lights went out. I don't know how long I laid there, but when I woke up, there was no panic down there or anything, but there was smoke and water knee deep. I run into a friend of mine that he was crying and asking me for help, and I looked at him in horror. And the skin on his face and his arms and everything was just hanging off like a mask or something. And I took hold of his arm. Skin all came off from my hand. And there was nothing in this world I could do for that boy. And that had bothered me all of my life. Gave the word to abandon ship, and we just practically stepped off of the quarterdeck into the water, and I guess I must have passed out and went down in the water, and everything was just as peaceful and nice that it would have been so easy to just let go. And I saw this bright light, and something made me come to, and so I got back up to the surface of the water, and oil all around, had water in my oil in my teeth and down my throat and everything. And tasted horrible. I still taste it today. The oil was a fire all around. The man saw me down there, and the fire was approaching me. It wasn't but 2 feet from me. And he reached down and pulled me up out of the water, and that man saved my life.
Has spent the entire mission searching the flats outside the harbor without finding any sign of the lost midget sub.
This is a mile. Okay. So what we're going to do is we're going to drop you down here
at the base.
Now, he's turning his attention to the steep coral escarpment running roughly parallel to the shore, an area he calls the wall.
In an expedition like this, you have to put your mind in the mind of the commander of the submarine, because his actions
are going to define the size of the search area. What he does at that moment is going to tell you how big a search area you have to have. Clearly, if he was killed outright, then you didn't have to put yourself in his mind at all because he's dead, and he's going to be right where they say he sank. But if he's still alive, he's going to then take certain evasive actions, and you have to then say, well, if I were that person, what would I do? And there were two options he had. One was to continue forward into Pearl Harbor, or the other was to turn and run for the high seas.
If the midget made a run for the high seas and sank farther out, there's no hope of finding it in the remaining time. But if it had continued toward the harbor, Ballard's team might stand a chance with the help of their own miniature submersible.
We've landed the sub. It's going to land about 200 meters of water, head due north. As you can see, the airport's right there, so it's going to run into something, and it's going to run into a wall. And then it's going to head west along that wall, because if the submarine hit against that wall, it's going to fall down to the base. So we're going to spend the day exploring the base of the steep scarp that leads right up the channel into Pearl Harbor.
Over to your port, looks like some more debris. I'm going to head over there.
In the control room, all anyone can do is listen to the squawk box.
Yeah, Mark, give us maybe like 15. I want to try to really nail this shot. It's pretty incredible.
They just reported finding a pile of batteries, and this submarine was a lot of batteries. So, starting to look like, smell like, but we're not sure.
Then, the sub-pilot spots a torpedo.
80, did he say? Right where it should get interesting, and it is getting interesting. He's picked up a torpedo and debris right in the area where we'd expect the submarine to impact it with the wall.
Ballard feels they are getting close, but they can't be sure of anything until they retrieve Deep Worker and take a look at the videotape.
The man who found the Titanic is not accustomed to failure, but now, as time runs out on this expedition, he must confront the possibility that the missing Japanese submarine may be beyond his reach. We'll be back with more in a moment.
National Geographic has been shaping the way we view our world for the last 113 years. Now this great legacy continues with the new National Geographic Channel. Call now and experience the continuing story of life on Earth, 7 days a week, 365 days a year. For availability, call 1-866-NAT-GEO-TV.
There's a stretch of avenue through this city that is made of concrete, neon, and poetry, that is populated by ticket takers, ushers, actors, and by the strange, the lonely, and the beautiful. And there's one night a year when every note, every detail is celebrated. The 2001 Tony Awards. Save your applause. Bring your Visa card. The only card accepted at the 2001 Tony Awards.
Lowe's Home Improvement Warehouse kicks off the summer this Memorial Day weekend. And what better way to kick it off than with free assembly of any gas grill we sell? From Weber to Coleman to Charbroil. And if you use your Lowe's card for purchases over $250, there are zero payments and zero finance charges for 6 months on everything you need, from appliances to tools to patio furniture. So this Memorial Day weekend, hurry to Lowe's, where we're improving home improvement.
You know that show, Frasier? The one about the two brothers who are psychiatrists. And they're always drinking cappuccinos and lattes. And the younger brother is always pining away for the English housekeeper. You know that show? Well, this guy's on the same network. NASCAR is coming to NBC and TNT this July. For all your sports news, log on to NBCI.com/NBC Sports.
You know when you're not feeling like yourself. You're tired all the time. You may feel sad, hopeless, and lose interest in things you once loved. You may feel anxious, can't even sleep. Your daily activities and relationships suffer. You know when you just don't feel right. Now here's something you may not know. These are some symptoms of depression, a serious medical condition affecting over 20 million Americans. While the cause is unknown, depression may be related to an imbalance of naturally occurring chemicals between nerve cells in the brain. Zoloft, a prescription medicine, works to correct this imbalance. When you know more about what's wrong, you can help make it right. Only your doctor can diagnose depression. Zoloft is not for everyone. People taking medicines called MAOI shouldn't take Zoloft. Side effects may include dry mouth, insomnia, sexual side effects, diarrhea, nausea, and sleepiness. Zoloft is not habit-forming. Talk to your doctor about Zoloft, the number one prescribed brand of its kind. Zoloft. When you know more about what's wrong, you can help make it right.
Direction?
Direction.
He said right, and then he said left. That's the building.
Is it?
Can you photo?
Introducing the Kodak Advantix preview camera.
Just push the button right there. Where is my head?
It's the only film camera that lets you see a picture right after you take it. So you'll always get the moment you want to share.
It's perfect. Share the moment, share life.
Shoot to thrill. Defy gravity, because it's not just a game anymore. June 15th, the premiere of Tomb Raider.
Absolutely.
And Monday on NBC, it's the Sixers and Bucks in crucial Game 4, Monday, 5 Eastern.
You know that show, Frasier? The one about the two brothers who are psychiatrists. And they're always drinking cappuccinos and lattes. You know that show? This guy's on the same network. NASCAR is coming to NBC and TNT this July.
Pearl Harbor, Legacy of Attack, continues now on NBC.
December 7th, 8:35 a.m., and the beginning of a brief 20-minute lull in the action. At airfields all over the island, crews scrambled to clear the runway so American planes could get in the air. Anti-aircraft guns were made ready. Field hospitals were set up to take care of the wounded, many of them burn victims. The first stories of individual acts of heroism began to make the rounds. One of them was about a mess attendant on the West Virginia named Dory Miller. Miller had carried the wounded captain of his ship to safety, then taken up a machine gun and shot down at least two Japanese planes. What made this story remarkable is that Dory Miller had never handled a machine gun, much less trained on one, because he was black. And like all African Americans in the 1941 Navy, restricted to the lowest ranking jobs. 14 men received America's highest military award, the Medal of Honor, for their heroism on that day. But Dory Miller wasn't one of them. He got the Navy Cross instead.
And the only reason why he didn't get the Congressional Medal, because he was black. You know, and the Navy being what it was at that time, you only could be a servant to the officers.
He never gave any thought for his life or anything. He grabbed a machine gun and he just started blasting away over the side of the ship. What he did was courageous. And many of us thought that man should have been given the Congressional Medal of Honor.
2 years after Pearl Harbor, Dory Miller died when his ship went down, torpedoed by a Japanese submarine. Pearl Harbor, 8:55 a.m. The seas were still boiling with smoke and flame. when the second wave of the Japanese attack struck the island. This time, 167 aircraft split into two main groups. One headed inland, the other hugged the eastern coast and continued south to Pearl Harbor. But this time, the Americans fought back. The harbor was now so thick, the Japanese pilots had trouble seeing their targets. One of the targets was the battleship Nevada, with a hole in her side, steaming toward the channel. Dive bombers honed in on the crippled giant. If they could sink the battleship now, it might block the channel and trap the fleet in the harbor.
With all of these planes coming in, when the Nevada got underway, the planes come in dive bombing that. It looked like bees coming back to the hive. There were so many of them in there at one time that it was amazing that they didn't collide.
With bombs falling all around, Nevada's commander was able to run his ship aground on Hospital Point, which kept her from sinking and left the channel clear. By 10 o'clock, it was over. The second wave of attackers headed back to their carriers, leaving behind a shattered American Pacific fleet.
December 7th, 1941, a date which will live in infamy. The United States of America was suddenly and deliberately attacked by naval and air forces of the Empire of Japan. The United States was at peace with that nation.
On the mainland, Americans were stunned by the news they were hearing from Pearl Harbor.
Every American alive over 65 years of age can remember exactly where they were and what they were doing when they got the news. It was a unifying event. It brought us together. Nothing else could have done it in that way.
And dastardly attack by Japan on Sunday, December.
President Roosevelt addressed the Congress the following day.
A state of war has existed between the United States and the Japanese Empire.
By December 11th, the United States was at war with Germany and Japan, plunging it into a conflict that would forever change its place in the world. Back in Pearl Harbor, one problem survivors faced was notifying people back home that they were okay.
The Navy told us that everybody send a postcard home to your parents, let them know everything's all right. Well, I got one of the last postcards out of there, and I sent it home on December the 9th, exactly when I sent it home. And my mother didn't get that postcard until February, the first week of February sometime. I don't know why it took so long, but that's what it did. She didn't know if I was alive or dead. When the mailman got the card at the post office, he closed down the office and ran all the way to my house. He woke my mother and stepfather up at 6 o'clock in the morning and told them, your son's okay, here's a card. I still have that card. My mom, she couldn't believe it. I get emotional when I think about it, how she says she felt. I just don't know. it just turns me on.
Jack McCarran had been married to his high school sweetheart, Roberta, for 7 weeks when the attack came. It wasn't until Christmas Day that she found out what had happened to her husband, who was stationed on the Arizona.
The Navy Department deeply regrets to inform you that your husband, John Harry McCarran, gunner's mate, 2nd U.S. Navy, has been reported wounded in action in the performance of his duty and in the service of his country. This was received by me Christmas morning, 7 a.m., December 25th, 1941. Yuck. Yep, I hate to say this, but in my entire 81 years of living, that was the worst time my entire life was to have received this telegram, because I had no idea whether or not my husband of 49 days was alive or dead.
Lying in a hospital on Oahu, badly burned, Jack decided to spare his new wife the horror of seeing him again.
I said, Tell Roberta to forget about me and go back to Saugus. So, you know, I've been burned, and I didn't look like me. I guess my face and my hair was only like a, you know, shot.
On top of which, it being Christmas, I was 3,000 miles away from my home. 3,000 miles away from my husband. I didn't know anybody.
I guess I never did write to you for
No.
I didn't write to her for a long time.
The state of shock I was in was almost as bad as his.
Well, some time passed before I probably started coming out of it, and I was aboard ship, and, you know, I loved this girl. And I realized that if I was going to survive, it would be with her.
My friends and shipmates took me over to the sick bay at Fort Dollar. And they laid me alongside the bulkhead over there. And I looked over another shipmate laying across from me and against the bulkhead. And he was holding his intestines in with his hand. And he looked up at me, and he said, "It's sure war, sure is hell, isn't it, shipmate?" And I said, "Yeah, it is." Well, lately I was diagnosed with stomach cancer, and I don't figure I have too many more years to live. And I thought that perhaps I might be a poor spokesman, so to speak, for my shipmates in telling my story so that they wouldn't be forgotten. And that's one and only reason that I came back. And I'm a kind of a private person. It's been hard to do, but I think it was time that it needed to be told. And I think it has been well worth it. I feel a lot better now.
Pearl Harbor, Legacy of Attack will return on NBC.
This company invested millions developing a sure thing. Unfortunately, it was not such a sure thing. Over three very long nights, the software helped them to analyze sales and customer feedback to quickly re-engineer the sure thing. The software is not flustered by this sudden turn of events because the software does not fear change. Always nimble and ready to rumble. Enterprise Software from Microsoft.
Own the original Pearl Harbor Epic. Tora, Tora, Tora. Now available on video and DVD.
Summer must be here. Time time for the JCPenney Memorial Day sale with 20 to 50% savings on everything for summer. Plus, take an extra 10% off with your Penny's card. It's all inside. Summer's on. JCPenney.
Chew, baby.
There are so many things in this world to try.
Chew, baby.
Don't let heartburn spoil your appetite for life. When it flares up, Chew Surpass, the new, long-lasting, antacid chewing gum that puts out heartburn. Lickety-split. Go ahead. Eat up all life has to offer. Just don't forget to chew. New Surpass Antacid Gum. Chew through heartburn.
Chew through heartburn fast.
New at 11, two children make a shocking discovery, a badly decomposed body wrapped in a rug. We're live with the big story. Good evening, I'm Michael Ann Wolf.
And I'm Art Edwards. Only on four, security guards and a shoplifter clash. Local 4 cameras roll as the scuffle comes to an end.
In good health, are you getting more than just change at the grocery store? See why money may also be rich in germs.
And the first hurricane of the season is headed for land.
And Reynolds is watching a drier Memorial Day forecast.
Voyager, adventurer, and explorer of the seas. Rock climbing in the morning, skating in the afternoon, theater in the evening. Brag for a lifetime. Want to see more stuff you can do? Check out RoyalCaribbean.com and get out there.
Buick's Memorial Day bonus cash ends May 31st. Make your move now. With bonus cash, now get $1,250 cash allowance and 0% APR financing on the 2001 Buick Century. That's thousands in average finance savings. Century with all these features standard and pay no interest ever. See dealer for residency and other restrictions. $1,250 cash allowance and 0% APR. Hurry to your Metro Detroit Buick dealer by May 31st. It's all good.
Finding talent is a big part of my job. The opening of the new Talent Freeway website is changing the way Michigan employers recruit their talent. Now they don't have to travel any farther than their computers to find a bank of qualified employees or post positions. Visit Talent Freeway at www.talentfreeway.org, a one-stop service solution for Michigan employers and residents. It provides career planning, skill assessment, education, and training. It's time for the Talent Freeway. Career development works.
The Toro Super Blower. You can't buy a more powerful handheld blower. Put the finishing touches on just about anything. The self-propelled Toro Personal Pace Mower. It adjusts to your pace, however slow or fast that may be.
Excuse me. Can I join you?
We're kind of busy right now.
The Whopper says beauty is in the taste buds of the beholder. Try the tasty flame-broiled Western Whopper.
In the land of burgers, Whopper is king.
Get in the locker room!
Tonight! Get it!
Will he succeed in his final attempt to find the missing submarine? We return to Pearl Harbor, Legacy of Attack, on this special edition of National Geographic Channel Presents.
It's the final day of the search, and Ballard has had his machines in the water for hours. But he's not hopeful about the outcome.
We're in the final throes of this expedition. I mean, today is the last day. We have two subs going in the water right now, but we're, you know, it doesn't look good because we've looked at all the high priority sites and we haven't found the midget submarine. We're now out in the very low priority areas, and that can go on forever because it's a big ocean. So I'd be very surprised if we succeeded today.
Deep Worker returns from its pass at the wall and is hoisted out of the water for the final time. With it is a videotape of the debris it encountered. The news isn't encouraging.
We have a possibility, but I personally am not overly optimistic.
A quick review of the videotape confirms Ballard's fears. On closer examination, what had looked to the sub-pilot like a pile of batteries turns out to be something else.
Looks like anti-aircraft gun clips. Or AK-AKs. Or... yeah. You know what it looks like to you?
And the torpedo the pilot spotted has had its warhead removed, so it can't be from the lost midget sub.
You reach a moment when you know you're not going to succeed. Because you've given it the best shot. You're going back over the same territory, seeing the same targets a second or third time. Well, we found a bunch of junk. We don't really have a definitive set of objects that says that the submarine broke up, but it could have.
The mystery of what happened to the midget subs would have been even deeper had it not been for our surprise development on the morning of December 8th, 1941. In the early morning hours, a small submarine washed ashore on Oahu's east coast. It was the one piloted by Ensign Kazuo Sakamaki, the sub with the gyroscope problems. Sakamaki also washed ashore, exhausted and delirious. He was captured before he could kill himself, and thus became America's first prisoner of war. Of the 10 submariners who set out before dawn on the 7th, Sakamaki was the only one who survived. Historians have generally labeled the submarine mission a failure, since only one midget that we know of entered the harbor and was sunk during the attack after firing two harmless torpedoes. But analysis of a photo taken from a Japanese airplane just as the battle began suggests something else. It shows Battleship Roe already under attack a few minutes after 8, and in the water just beyond, a shadowy shape that appears to be a small submarine and the wake of a torpedo aimed directly at the West Virginia. While some historians remain skeptical, that analysis could explain a message Dewa received on the night of the 7th, more than 12 hours after the attack. It came from his friend, Ensign Yokoyama. Successful surprise attack, then silence. Yokoyama sub never made the rendezvous, and neither did any of the others. For years, Dewa has wondered what happened to Yokoyama and all the others who didn't come back. All he knows is that somewhere in these waters, they died, as they expected they would.
Of course, I hope they would return. But the commander told me, if I come back, I'll come back with a wolf, as we say in Japan, and put the mother sub in danger. So I don't think they planned to return, even if they had succeeded.
Before he set out on his mission, one of the submariners left behind a poem he'd written earlier that day.
As the cherry blossoms fall at the height of their glory, so too must I fall, that men may call me a flower of Yamato, though my bones lie scattered in the bleak wilderness of strange and distant lands.
On the last day of his visit, Dewa asked to see the Arizona Memorial to to pay his respects to the Americans who died on December 7th.
America and Japan must have had their reasons for starting a war. But after coming here and seeing the waves of the Pacific, I question why we had to go to war. Japan and the United States are brothers. Pacific peace is world peace. This trip has made me feel that together we must protect it.
Jack McCarran and Carl Carson are also there to remember their ship and their shipmates. Underwater, the National Geographic camera prowls through the empty ship. These are the first images of the officers' quarters, images from another era, frozen in time. A bathroom with its regulation soap dish. Officer's desk, its papers still arranged in their pigeonholes. A wash basin, now filled with sand, beneath a shaving mirror. For Jack McCarran, the pictures of his old ship are almost too painful to bear.
Over 40 years, I couldn't, if I was asked, I couldn't talk. I didn't talk about it, I didn't think about it. I had erased it from my mind. I didn't have any memories. I really didn't. I saw that barnacles on that doorknob and the light in the overhead. The thoughts were, who was that officer down in there? Did he survive? At one time, that knob was real nice and shiny, and he turned on that light to read. I don't remember the ship as that.
Legacy of Attack will return on NBC.
If you have osteoarthritis, there's reason to celebrate. It's Celebrex.
Celebrate, celebrate, come on and celebrate.
Celebrex targets only the COX-2 enzyme, a key source of arthritis pain. Celebrex relieves arthritis pain plus inflammation and stiffness, too. Woo! Celebrex should not be taken if you've had aspirin-sensitive asthma or allergic reactions due to aspirin or other arthritis medicines, or certain drugs called sulfonamides. In rare cases, serious stomach problems such as bleeding can occur without warning. Tell your doctor if you have kidney or liver problems. Powerful 24-hour relief from osteoarthritis pain, inflammation, and stiffness. Ask your doctor about prescription Celebrex.
Here's a stirring development, the Big Paint Sale at Sears. As in big deals on the full spectrum of primers, stains, and paints. It's part of the big Memorial Day weekend sale. At these prices, you'll have enough to paint the whole neighborhood. Only through Monday at Sears. This is where the rubber meets the road. The big Memorial Day weekend sale at Sears. Right now, save big with 10 to 25% off top brands of tires like Michelin, Dunlop, Pirelli, and more. For whatever you drive, the big weekend sale only at Sears.
Good morning. Or is it? If you're quitting smoking, you should know that in the morning, Nicoderm CQ gives you a higher level of medicine than the round store patch and stays higher all morning long. CQ's behavioral support program is clinically proven. Theirs isn't. And CQ's the more gradual patch. Quitting is tough. Take all the help you can get. Nicoderm CQ, the power to calm, the power to comfort, the power to help you quit.
Sweetie.
Sweetie.
Sweet and sweetie.
Spicy, wasty.
Introducing new spicy barbecue strips from KFC. They're sweet and spicy at the same time.
Ooh.
So how do you describe them?
Sweetie.
Spicy. Sawaisanala.
Honey and smoked jalapeno barbecue sauce on freshly prepared whole white meat strips.
Whoa!
For a limited time, get side biscuit and three spicy barbecue strips for just $2.99. And for wing lovers, eight wings for just $2.99. They're,
sweet and spicy!
I'm General Norman Schwarzkopf. Join me on MSNBC for an extraordinary first-hand account. Pearl Harbor, attack on America.
Monday on MSNBC.
Monday on CNBC, a National Geographic Explorer event. A mouthwatering look at some ferocious eaters. Back-to-back episodes of Unforgiving Appetites, the Memorial Day feeding frenzy. National Geographic Explorer on CNBC, Monday at 8.
The attack on Pearl Harbor lasted less than 2 hours. But for those who survived, it would take so much longer to fully comprehend the magnitude of the devastation.
For 3 days after the attack, the Arizona continued to burn. The final totals from the surprise assault were staggering. More than 2,400 deaths and almost 1,200 wounded. 21 ships of the U.S. Pacific Fleet had been sunk or damaged, including all 8 battleships. Over 300 airplanes had been put out of commission. Admiral Yamamoto had accomplished everything he set out to do, except destroy the American aircraft carriers. And in the fighting to come, that would prove to be a critical failure.
One of the best things that ever happened in the United States was our carriers were not involved in the attack. Yamamoto sank battleships, but the battleship was not the queen of the seas any longer. After that day, from now on, it's the aircraft carrier. And the attack on Pearl Harbor, for all of the losses of lives, which comes first, of course, and the losses of ships, they didn't sink any aircraft carriers. And that made what was already a very bad mistake on Japan's part even worse.
But perhaps the greatest miscalculation was how the defeat would affect the American fighting spirit. Instead of being a crippling blow, it became a rallying cry.
The next morning, the fire was still burning, and there was the ship, some of them, and I'm not for sure that some of them that still had the flag flying from yesterday. And at 8 o'clock, guess what? These ships are sitting there in the mud. It's time to raise the flag, and there's the American flag flying. Everything is fine.
And then the Americans went to work. Every ship that had been hit, except the Arizona, Utah, and Oklahoma, was refloated, repaired, and put back into service. Many would take part in the battles yet to come. Guadalcanal, Iwo Jima, Okinawa, and so would the men who survived that day.
I grew up in the Navy. I learned a lot. When I came out of the Navy, I was 6 foot even, weighed 200 pounds. I actually grew up. I learned to be, we say, a man.
When I walk as a Pearl Harbor survivor, especially when I have my uniform on, I walk very proud. I represent the country, and I will represent it to the day I die. And I will always be proud to be part of it.
Pearl Harbor to me is like beginning a new life. I may be a certain age, but it seemed that I was reborn that day.
Pearl Harbor survivors are special. They have a feeling for each other and for their country. They have a comradeship that is not matched anywhere in the civilian world. The only people that I've ever met who have that kind of comradeship are foxhole buddies. These guys were in a foxholes together. It's not a feeling of we showed them. It's not a feeling of triumph. It's a feeling of we did it together. We were there. And that's what matters.
It's kind of a hallowed place, and it's very beautiful. And I'm amazed that it's this beautiful. And I understand that there's millions of visitors every year that come by and pay their respect to my shipmates. To lots of them, I know a lot of them, those are just names. But to me, they'll always be my shipmates.
I don't think we'll ever be done with Pearl Harbor. I think Pearl Harbor is like Gettysburg. It's like Appomattox. It's like Lincoln's assassination. It's like Yorktown and the surrender to General Washington. God help our country if it's ever forgotten.
Legacy of Attack will continue on NBC.
National Geographic has been shaping the way we view our world for the last 113 years. Now this great legacy continues with the new National Geographic Channel. Call now and experience the continuing story of life on Earth, 7 days a week, 365 days a year. For availability, call 1-866-NAT-GEO-TV.
Next at 11, children make a shocking discovery. A body wrapped in a rug. Local First is live.
A child is shocked by a downed power line. Paramedics rush him to the hospital and save his life.
And see why money may also be rich in germs.
Local First News at 11 is next.
Want to smooth away your frizz?
Smoother.
Get Pantene Frizz Control Smoothing Cream.
Smoother than smooth.
So glad I found you.
Smooth your hair with Pantene Moisturizing Pro-V Formula.
Smoother than smooth.
In just 10 days, it'll make your hair up to 70% smoother and healthier.
So glad I found you.
Transform your hair in just 10 days. Smooth Care Collection from Pantene Pro-V.
Summer must be here. Time for the JCPenney Memorial Day Sale with 20 to 50% savings on everything for summer. Plus, take an extra 10% off with your Penny's card. It's all inside. Summer's on. JCPenney.
Best Western is the largest hotel chain in the world. Over 4,000 hotels in over 80 countries, all inviting you to get a good night's sleep. Best Western, the world's largest hotel chain. Call 1-800-WESTERN.
Thousands of people will win. Great prizes, new cars, and millions of advantage miles. Playing NBC's trivia game, NBC IQ. All you need to play is a free QTV kit from Radio Shack. Then watch NBC and play NBC IQ. Find out how at any Radio Shack or NBC.